plaid flannel, and no one dared to destroy your spell. So sit back, have a chill pill or a Zima. Do they even make Zima anymore? They make Zima in the first place. Doesn't matter. Sit back, enjoy yourselves. To open your eyes. As Shit and Champagne in the Temple of Poon, or Sex in the City Live with drag queens, or quite recently, Bitch Slam. And once, under very strange circumstances, no fault of the clubber, an ill-fated voyage we called Psycho the Musical. And I'm thrilled to be here with Katya, a Bittersweet 90s symphony, the Seattle's. Now I know some of you are thinking to yourself, but Katya, the Seattle's, I mean, what could you, great mezzo-soprano understudy, possibly knowing about the grunge or the rock and roll of the 1990s? Well, Katya, the 90s? Really? Valid questions. Questions that will kind of be addressed in the next 75 to 95 minutes, depending how fast I talk and how amusing you all find what I have to say. Now this story story begins about 20 years after I came to the United States. I first arrived here in 1960, a long, long time ago. I was 21 years old, newly widowed. My late husband, the county folks, said, "You want to get Sky and pass away." Leaving me nothing, just my furs and yules, a Picasso, two Chagalls, and my petition, some lovely Louis Vuitton's furniture, a bed in my chateau of the scent. I was destitute. So I did what any 21-year-old destitute countess does. I sold that chateau and I bought a five-bedroom flat at the Dakota in New York City. Now, against all odds, I managed to create a life for myself in New York. Within several weeks, I was the heartbreak, the toast. I was the toast of New York, a virtual legend. And for 20 years, I was on every guest list to every bar in that city. I snorted cocaine with Liza Shaw. Everyone did. But it was a long time ago. And by the 90s, I saw the city change. Not for the better, no. The Times Square that I had loved, that dirty mess where you walked down the street dressed nicely and looked 10 times better than anyone else, it was like Disneyland. And the lights had dimmed so that I felt it was time to move on. You see, I had to think about my daughter, Catherine. Yes, I have a daughter, Kat. She's 32, getting older every day. But in the early 90s, she was entering her tween years. And I thought, well, Child Protective Services thought that it would be best if I spent more time mothering and less time out in the clubs, as the kids say. So I packed up the Bentley, and we headed out west to a little town where absolutely nothing was happening on the banks of Lake Washington. How was I ever to know that I would find myself in the middle of a musical restoration? Isn't it ironic? Don't you think? then leading his beautiful wife. And isn't it ironic? Don't you think? Charming woman. I had the great pleasure of meeting her years ago at a party of many Canadians who rock. There were so many Canadians who rocked back then. What happened? But it doesn't matter. I myself, of course, am not Canadian. I'm Russian. But the party was being thrown by my friend, Monsieur René Angive. He was celebrating his engagement to his child bride, Celine Dion. Few people know this. But I worked with Celine for many years. I was an addiction coach. You know, when we started working together at the very beginning of her career, she had this very, very thick French-Canadian accent. I know, to sound her now, you'd think she was as American as apple cake, but I'm getting ahead of myself. I'd like to take a moment to introduce this fabulous group of instrumental players. The Bittersweet. Hollywood Bowl last week. That's the caliber of musician I am. On drums, the lady who makes all the girls and boys go crazy, my rock, my dear friend, was Roberta Drake. On bass, giving us our luscious bearded portion for the evening, Mr. Dave Gerson. On cowbell and guitar, my dear friend, the Gregoire, Mr. Greg Robles. And at the piano, this charming, glasses wearing gentleman, with my dear, dear friend and musical director, the man responsible for many of the artistic versions of songs that you will be hearing here tonight, Mr. Joseph Lee. It's marvelous to have such wonderful musicians up here on the stage with me. And you're darling, you are old enough to remember the 90s, probably. Everyone on this stage is old enough to remember the 90s. I mean, most of the 90s. If you remember the whole thing, you were doing something very, very wrong. No, but for anyone here who's too young to remember the 90s, or too old to give a shit, the 90s was sort of a transitional decade. They were a decade full of bizarre things that really never should have happened, yet somehow did. It was a time period where people thought wearing a Yanko Yeed with a 20-inch hem on each leg, along with a crop top with a spaghetti strap and a bunch of alligator clips in your hair, was completely acceptable. This was a time when Roseanne, Friends, and Seinfeld ruled the airways, where if you wanted to buy a song, you had to go to a store where there were people who had feelings and purchased it, you know, on a tape or a CD. It was a time where you were willing to wait a minute and a half for some ridiculous noise on your phone to take you to internet land invented by Al Gore, where you could join a catfishing room called a chat place. It was a time where if you were running late to meet a friend at a Starbucks or a Yamba Youth or a Loaded Bagel, usually located in a strip mall across from an Old Navy, you'd have to pull over, take a regular phone and page someone, unless you were rich, in which case you had a car phone that cost $1 a minute. This was a time when MTV had played actual music videos at any hour. At any hour of the day except when real work was on, you could tune in to grunge or East Coast, West Coast, R&B or girl groups or boy bands. Boy bands, don't get me started. I never really understood mastered the phenomenal. I mean, if I wanted to see a bunch of, you know, teenage boys dancing around to songs that consist of three different chords, I could go see a High School Musical or Badlands anytime in the last 30 years. They were quite popular. My cadaver cat, she was particularly fond of a group called the Backstreeting Boys. And let me tell you, we saw them at the Seattle Astrodome. There was nothing backstreeting about them. That door, perhaps. But then again, it would make $134 million in their time together. So I suppose they were doing something right. Godmother of the grunge music. It's really a very simple story. You see, in the year 1991, Catherine and I arrived in Lake Washington, Seattle. We bought a lovely five-bedroom contemporary home at 174 Lake Washington Drive. And we began our new life. For the first time in decades, I could walk outside of my home to complete silence. No paparazzis, no gaggle of homosexual gentlemen just waiting to go out to the club with me. It was thrilling for about a day and a half, and then it got remarkably boring. I mean, I'm not cut out for full-time mothering, but you do what you have to. That's what I was just saying. On our
third or fourth week in town, we were sitting down for dinner, Katya and I. Now, we eat very late, around 9:30, because I will not let the young thing eat until all her homework and chores are done. So, there we were, eating our cocoban, and I hear this noise out of the garden. Well, I went out to investigate, as I was doing, and there, laid out drunk in the shadow of the bougainvillea, I saw this hobo. So I did what any good Sumerian and mother would do. I hosed him off, and I had Kat just drag him into the house and put him in the guest room. We Russians believe that you should always know in your neighborhood hobo. I mean, they have so much knowledge about the neighborhood. It's good to be on that good side. Well, anyway, I went to bed with the hobo in the next room, and at about 4 in the morning, I got up. My throat needed some clearing, so I thought a nice shot of vodka would help. And to my surprise, the hobo was in the kitchen making coffee. Turns out he wasn't a hobo at all. He was my neighbor. That's right. Rather prominent gentleman. He was tiny as could be. He was the lead singer of a band called the Nirvana. His name was Mr. Kurt Cobain. He lived directly next door. Charming gentleman. He was so thankful, so appreciative that we'd helped him out and had started a friendship that lasted the rest of his life. He would show up at my house once, twice a week. We'd talk about music, art, politics, you name it. And he was a special man. A tiny man that you could put in your pocket. I mean, I seldom understood what he was talking about, but he was Kurt Cobain. You know, one night, we were sitting there having a cocktail, and he says to me, I hope I don't sound peculiar, but Kat smells wonderful. She's wearing a new perfume. Well, Kat was 13. 13-year-olds don't wear perfume unless they're harmless. No, she was wearing deodorant. It was a new brand. It was called Teen Spirit in the yellow canister. His eyes lit up. And that night, a genre of music was born.
Hello.
wonderful song, you know. It really is considered by most to be the most important song of the entire grunge movement. You know, it's funny though, it doesn't make a lot of sense actually if you look at the words, but then again, little of what Kurt said made much sense. He and I, we shared a philosophy. Music is not about lyrics or rhythm or notes. Music is about passion. And passion is something Kurt totally understood, although he was not the most passionate person in his household. No, no, that title went to his lovely wife, lead singer of the band, and my close personal friend, Miss Courtney Love. Yes, Courtney would be so pleased. You know, Courtney honestly was a charming, charming woman. I the first time she showed up at my house, she happened to have forgotten her shirt. But we had this instant connection. I mean, everyone says horrible things about Courtney, but honestly, you know, she's not that bad. In many ways, she reminds me of sort of a younger, more dirty, more drug-addled version of myself. Had I made some horrible decisions every year. But I took it upon myself to take her under my wing. I took it under my wing. You know, see, she was a mother. Her daughter Bean was only about 6 months old when we met. There's little Bean, such a cute child. But as I was saying, Courtney, believe it or not, had absolutely no natural motherly instincts. So I wanted to teach her a few things. You know, the basics of mothering, like if the baby's crying too much, just put a little brandy in with the milk. Shut the thing up. If your baby can't fall asleep, take a Xanax, cut it into 5 equal pieces, take the smallest piece, grind it up, put it in water, and then dilute it and dab it on the baby's gums. They fall right asleep, and you get 8 hours of undisturbed rest. Am I right, mother? People ask me, they say, Katya, where did you get such wonderful mothering tips? I don't know, I just come up with this stuff. And Kat, my daughter, she turned out fine. I mean, we don't talk much anymore. But who talks to their adult children anyway? You know, mothering wasn't the only thing I talked about with Courtney. I also, see, I saw the lady underneath all that grime and filth. And I wanted to help her become the lady she could be. You see, not all women are ladies, and not all ladies are women. But I talked things like how to apply makeup, how to dress appropriately, how to show your anger at a bar without knocking over a table or taking out the waiter, little things. And sure, not all of the tricks stuck, but you know, we Russians, we have a saying. We say, translate something like, you can take a goat to a river, but you can't make it drink the water if it prefers vodka. Or in Courtney's case, heroin.
Thank you.
piece of meat. Well, I'm not selling cheap. When she said, I'm not selling cheap, I thought she was saying, I'm not selling sheep, which made absolutely no sense. But then again, nothing she said ever really made sense. You know, she was, as I said, the most passionate woman I think I've ever known. She could go from laughing hysterically to screaming to punching the help in a matter of 5 or 6 seconds. And she often forgot to wear shirts. But nonetheless, she truly was a marvelous woman, and very undeserved of the horrible things that were said to her. You know, I remember when Kurt passed, she showed up at my door, just in tears, and I took her in my arms and I just held her. What I felt was, I felt like it was forever. You see, I knew where she was coming from. I myself am a widow, and I know the pain, the anger, the frustration that comes with that kind of loss. You know, in many ways, there were a lot of similarities between Kurt and Courtney and myself and the couch near Monster. I mean, of course, the obvious things. There was a height difference. Courtney was about 3 inches taller than Kurt. I was 1.5 feet taller than Nikki. There was an age difference. Courtney was 2 years older than Kurt. Nikki was 60 years older than myself. But the main thing our relationships had in common was the horrible way we were treated in the press. You know, people used to say of Courtney Love that she took Kurt into harder drugs, that she broke up the Nirvana, that she created an unstable environment, that she got him hooked on drinking cough syrup as a beverage. At least one of these things is completely untrue. He was hooked on the cough syrup long before they ever met. But it pained her greatly. And I felt that pain. You see, when I married him, the French papers, that's where I lived before I lived in Europe. They wrote that I was a, how you call it, a gold miner. I mean, what could a 17-year-old woman possibly want with a 77-year-old, one-eyed, semi-mobile cow? But I promise you, what we shared was real, true love. That man, he honestly was my other half. And I knew when I married him that I would spend the rest of his life with me. For three marvelous years, we were each other's other halves, you know? And I miss him terribly. To this day, it's been 45, a long, long time since he died. And I think of him often. I wish that I could see him again. I'd give up anything to talk, to be lulled to sleep by his snoring, but I know that's not why we know. If you take nothing away from the show, just remember, it doesn't matter what other people say about the choices you make in life. In the end, you only have one life to live, and unless you decide to share it with someone else, then it's really nobody else's business. Maestro, let's sing this.
This moment, and all.
so much. You know, the time I spent with Nikki was among the happiest years of my life. In many ways, I think that union was the thing that brought me more joy than anything else. I mean, of course, the singing of the popera, the entertainment, that brings me joy too. Oh, and mothering my daughter Kat, that was fun. No, I joke about Kat all the time, but when Catherine was a little girl, just a little baby, she was like a little dog to me, and I took her everywhere I went, matching outfits. Then I'd be at the Algonquin Room or at Boy Bar. I'd pay one of the go-go dancers $10 to watch her in the back when I did my set. It was marvelous. Of course, by the time, I know, there's a photo apparently. That was a good night. You know, by the time that we moved, by the time we left New York and moved to Seattle, Kat was just too old for bars. And I had a great deal of difficulty finding common grounds between us. We were just very different people. I mean, I'm like a diamond inside of a Fabergé egg, inside of a small velvet pouch. And Kat is more like, well, a very clean beige stone inside a Jane Austen novel, inside of a Jansport backpack. It had a lot in common. Not my fault. That all changed, thank goodness, when Kat was about 13. You see, I read somewhere in a magazine that caffeine stunts growth, and by that point, Kat was already about 5'4", and I figured, why send her through a life of tallness? It's so hard to fit on airplanes. So I put her on a diet of caffeine pills and coffee. Every day after school, we just drive down to the Pike's Place Starbucks, and she would have a couple espressos, and she would do her homework and talk about her day, and I'd just sit there playing with my gigapet and listening, or doing whatever it is people do at Starbucks. And one day I felt this tap on my shoulder. A woman asked me if she could borrow a pen. We got to talking. This woman, who happened to be a fellow musician, a lady of the rock and roll, her name was Sarah McGarkin, the one who sings the really sad song about the puppy and the kitty. I promised myself I wouldn't get emotional. There was no crying in cabaret. We got to talking to philanthropizing, and we were discussing the difficulties of being a woman in this male-dominated business we call show. And I said to her, I said, Sarah, wouldn't it be great if there was some kind of festival produced by women, for women performers, and women and paid gentlemen guests to come to? And maybe we should call it something like a name of a famous Jewish heroine, like, I don't know, like Lilith or something. But she thought it was a wonderful idea, and then she left. Well, 1 year later, I picked up my copy of Entertainment Weekly. What did I find? Yes, I've been a subscriber since 1991. Thank you very much. Still missing one episode from when I moved, it doesn't matter. As I was saying, it announced the creation of Lilith Fair. Now, I was not hurt that I was not included as a founding member of the fair, considering there's only so many places for faces on that cover. But I will say, my feelings were a little hurt by the fact that I wasn't invited to perform. So I called Sarah up, and I said, Sarah, I'm happy to perform with you. And she said, well, Katya, I would have invited you, but you're such a big star, you might outshine the others. Wise woman, that Sarah. She really was. She invited me to be the sort of unofficial understudy for Lilith Fair, which I was for many years. For the first two, however, I did not perform. But on the third year, we were in Los Angeles, and it rained. Now, if any of you have been to Los Angeles on a day when it rains, it might as well be like a war zone, like a damn nuclear bomb exploded on the city, because those people lose their shit. Gwen Stefani and No Doubt were performing that year. Unfortunately, there was a large puddle in
front of Gwen's door, and she simply could not navigate around it. And so I was forced to go on. And a Billboard magazine called my performance indescribable. I called it genius.
My knees. That's a very encouraging sign. You like our song? This is vintage 1996, Mr. David Lambert. Trivia, David Lammermoor, my designer, my couturier, as we say, of Corsairs, he actually designed the Harlequin jumpsuit that Lady Miss Kia wears in the video for Groovies in the Heart. It was constructed from 5 pairs of Harlequin tights and now resides in a box in Kia's mother's garage in New Jersey, and so many good memories from the 90s do. Now, people ask me all the time when I was preparing for this song, they say, Katya, what was it like? There you were in this completely heterosexual city, in your sexual pride. How was it? Did you have lovers? Well, you know, I had lots of lovers in the 70s and the 80s, but I found that in the 90s, I was too focused on creating an environment for artists to thrive. We called it the Seattle Salon. I also spent my days mothering my daughter Catherine. That's why I was in Seattle. But honestly, any night, you see, word of my arrival had gotten out. And any night, key players from the Seattle music scene and my friends from Hollywood and New York, they just stopped by, you know, to talk, to conversate, to inspire each other, to lay down a track in my recording studio, yes. I have a recording studio. I had one in my old house. I converted the conservatory. I filled it with ferns and palms and microphones. We called it our sound garden. Who took the name first? I don't know. It was the 90s, man. Everything was fun and exciting. You know, on any given night, you might find Dave Grohl sipping cognac with Paula Abdul, or Chris Cornell discussing cars with Tracy Chapman, and never ask her about the fast car. She does not like discussing it. You know what I mean, dear? Well, one night I even caught Yalo onto the night, teaching the boys some Chumbawamba dance moves. Now, I know what some of you are thinking to yourself. You're thinking, but Katya, this all sounds a bit far-fetched. I mean, how could all of this have happened without us knowing about it? Well, it was the 90s. There was no internet. We celebrities had our own lives back then. And I have this amazing skill. All I have to do is think about a thing, say it a few times, and it just becomes truth. That's the way the world works. I don't know, it's a gift. It's a gift, really. But then again, this was the 90s. Nothing made sense. Why does the snow fall down on you? How can one be kissed by a rose on the wind? What is a margarine? Who is the real Slim Shady? And does crisscross really make you want a yum yum? Questions for the ages. None of these concepts make any sense, and yet they made artists and record companies millions of dollars. I think the greatest example of this duplicity kind of thing in music was a band called the Bare Naked Ladies. Now, have you heard of them? They were a group of rather classically attractive Canadian gentlemen, though I doubt had actually seen a naked lady in their life before they got a black album. Yet they managed to write a song, a rap action, that includes concepts like golf, sushi, the filmography of Kurosawa, and the greatness of the flavor of vanilla, and the dulcet tunes of Leanne Rimes. And yet somehow this song sat at the top of the Billboard Hot 100 for 2 consecutive weeks. That alone defines the 1990s. It's been 1 week since you looked at me. Drop your hip to the side and said, I'm angry. 1 week since you laughed at me, you said, get it together. See me 3 days since the living room. I really
pick up my shirt and be,
what is it you got to pay?
It was a Tuesday, so it was a particularly slow night. It was just Ed, myself, Callista Flockhart, and Harrison Ford. Yes, I introduced Han Solo to Ally McBeal. Well, after a heavy night of Smirnoff ice drinking, the four of us, we cuddled up on the sofa, we turned off the lights, and we watched the X-Files as my darling Kat slept in her Sailor Moon sleeping bag at our feet. 1 week later, a hit was born. Did Ed ever thank me for the inspiration I gave him? No, he did not, but I don't mind. No, I love to help others create, to inspire young things to growing. In many ways, I think of myself as a regular Dalai Levi, you know, spreading manure, encouraging growth from it. And over the years, I've encouraged many a young artist. You know, I taught them how to pick the right song, how to dress appropriately, how to maintain your composure on a stage after 5 or 7 shots before the show. I was able to take tiny grains of talent and create megastars. You know, I remember in about, it must have been 1995 or so, I sat down with a very young Christina Aguilera. Our mothers went to the same manicurist. I said to her, and I'll never forget, I said, Xtina, you need to drop this Mickey Mouse Club drag and show yourself off. I mean, if I had a waist that small, I would constantly expose it. Maybe put a nice little belly button ring in there. Here's some video cassettes of Barbara Eden and I Dream of Genie. That's what was her first hit? Genie in a Bottle. I didn't drop the microphone, it's expensive to live in. No, and she wasn't the only one I met, but no. I remember a very, very young Yule came over to my house. For all I knew, she was just some Alaskan yodeler, but she was a charming child, and she was a prankster. All the time, she would run around my house, just hiding things. One day, she hid my beloved heart-shaped box, the one where I keep my jagged little pills. She put it behind a jar of pearl jam, and I couldn't find it anywhere. So I took her aside, and I said, you have got to stop these foolish games. Pans are not made for thieving. Only you can save your soul. You were meant for bigger things, and I was meant for you. Apparently she listened to a little talk, because she wrote songs inspired by that lecture that charted for 134.
4 weeks that I get to thank you with the Grammy speeches. No, but it's all right. I know, and that's all that matters. You know, even today, I still mentor young talent. You see, when I moved to San Francisco in 1999 to embrace the world of cabaret, I found myself in the sort of clutches of the drag community. Now why the drag queen, those beautiful painted ladies, chose to welcome this middle-aged Russian countess into the inner septum, I shall never know. But they taught me many things, including the concept of the drag family. In Dragland, you can just choose people you want to be related. So, you know, an aged performer will say, I claim you to some talented young person. You teach them a couple of things, give them a dress, maybe some jewelry, or you just throw them to the wolves. It doesn't matter. Because you are forever linked together as family. In my tenure in San Francisco, I have only claimed two young ladies to be my children. And I'm so happy to have one of them here tonight to sing with me. She's beautiful, she's talented, she's civil-minded, she's kind, she's glamorous. She is everything I ever wished for in a child of my own and never got. Cat doesn't like it when I say those things. But luckily, Cat's not here tonight, so. She never comes to my shows. Please welcome to the stage, my dog, Ms. Katya. Yeah. Can I talk to you for a moment?
Well, sure. You know, you look kind of familiar.
I should have been your drag mother. I was just wondering, do you know someone named... You know his name?
Oh, yeah, definitely. I know his name.
I just want to let you know, he's mine.
No, no, he's mine. You need to give it up. I've had about enough. It's not hard to see the boy is mine. I'm sorry that you seem to be confused. He belongs to me. The boy is mine.
I think it's time we got this straight. We sit and talk. I've never gone after one of my daughter's men before. And I do love your man. He's adorable. He's not here tonight.
He's not here tonight.
Mine actually is tonight.
Oh, see, there you go.
That was shame. I love these words that the drag queens teach me. It's
a shame.
All right, darling, would you like to sing a number for these nice people?
Sure, yes.
Who that is.
you. I just want to throw a shout out to all the drag family that's in the house. Who's here tonight? I just want to look in the crowd and see anyone from around. Well, there's Darcy, darling, you're right there. Yes, hi. I see the Ruby. Is that Lee right next to you? Yes, so many gorgeous faces. How about Oasis, huh? Is it this club? Alright, I want to bring to the stage one more time this evening the incomparable Katya Smirnoff-Sky!
Yeah!
What's funny is I know technically that song was written in 1988 by the Guns and the Roses, but I did not become familiarized with the song until 1998 when I sang backup for Sheryl Crow. That's right, I met Sheryl. Sheryl and I met back in 1987. You know, we met in 1990 filming an episode of Cop Rock. Yeah. She was on Cop Rock. It only lasted 6 episodes. I was going to be on episode number 10 playing a child trafficker, a Russian one, because that's what Russians do, traffic children. Sadly, my episode never aired. It was my one big chance for an ego. Oh, what a sad, but I'm not. Bygones. Sheryl and I stayed close for all those years, and in 1997, when she was recording her Globe sessions, she invited me to come and sing backup for her. All the high harmonies on that album, Katya. You can find it right there in the liner notes, if they still made liner notes. One of the greatest troubles of the entire music, Napster. I blame Napster. When Napster came, it killed the music industry, which made all the great record stores close, which meant that people who would have been browsing for music now had more time to do things like think about their health, which caused them to eliminate smoking in bars, which made nicotine and liquor sales plummet into a death spiral where old people and children and businessmen invested all of their life savings in Beanie Baby collecting, which at the time seemed like a perfectly legitimate way to spend your money. But unfortunately, the market became oversaturated, a bubble burst or something, and old people lost everything, and they had to move to Florida, where rents were cheap, and you had to put no money down on a house, and because they were old, they didn't have the strength in their arm to pull down on voting machines, and we had hanging chads, and then President Bush got elected, the second one, and the world went to shit all because of Napster. Not over. I mean, I understand. The world is changing. We were at the precipice of a new century. You know, staring into a new millennia, as they call it. And people were scared, and life was changing very quickly. Mine included. You see, my salons that I had built and worked so hard at, where we had fostered so many a great artist, started to wane in popularity, partially because of a minor lawsuit I had with Madonna, where I claimed that I had written as much A Beautiful Stranger as she did, which was about 1%. She didn't like that. Well, next thing I know, all the A-listers stopped coming. The Stone Temple Pilots, the Green Days. All I was left with was ex-cast members from the real world and DJ Flavor Flav. So it was then that I made a very a hard choice to close my salon doors forever, to live in the solitude. My good friends, Courtney Knowles and Nick Salott, the sisters Wilson from Hawk, they still stop by all the time, but it wasn't the same. Seattle was no longer the hot plate of musical inhalation that it had once been. I'd walk out onto those streets, the streets in that city I had chosen to make my home, and I felt like a stranger. San Francisco in 1999. You see, in 1999, my daughter Catherine, she graduated from high school and she went off to college at Berkeley or Stanford or City College of San Francisco. I don't remember which one. It doesn't matter. Her father, Liza Minnelli, paid for it all. That's a story for another show, ladies. But there I was, for the first time in my life, completely alone in my house. No child, no celebrities to inspire. I felt like it was time for a change, not to mention the IRS had found me. How was I to know that performers have to pay taxes on the income we make singing? I mean, isn't the point of taxes to make the world a better place? And isn't that what I do on stage? It doesn't matter. I packed my Bentley and I drove south all the way to San Francisco to a new world of cabaret and drag, and I've never looked back. I mean, sure, I loved the 90s, who didn't? And I had a front row seat to one of the greatest musical adventures that our times have ever known. But all good things come to an end, and this show is coming to an end now. Now, I know that I haven't sang all of your favorite songs, but let's just put it this way. It's closing time. One more call for alcohol. No liquor and beer. It's closing time. You don't have to go home.
Thank you.
But you can't stay. Yeah, well, you can stay here at the show afterwards. But I'm going to sing one more song for you. And hopefully it'll be every one of your favorite songs from the 90s, because there's about 40 songs left.
I don't want no scrub. The scrub is a bad thing.
special guest vocalist is Honey Mahogany. We'd like to thank all the staff here. And let's bring it back one more time. Please welcome back to the stage the Countess Katya Smirnoff-Sky.
A bittersweet 90s symphony, a completely indulgent piece of show that I love for pleasing myself, mainly. I'm so glad that it pleased so many of you. I'd like to thank the wonderful team at Oasis, Sarah and... Sophia, of course, who I've worked with several times for Little Women. I'd like to thank Richard Winchester, who did my beautiful slides and went through my photo book. The wonderful staff, I'd like to thank Darcy, Helena, and Jeff, who runs this marvelous stuff. There's a couple of wonderful shows coming up. It is closing time for my show, but it's not closing time for the bar. They will be having some kind of event called, like, Big Dick or something like that. I don't remember. Big Fat Dick. I'm sorry, I missed that. And you can stay for Big Fat Dick if you would like to. Jason Sayers will be here tomorrow.
Justin
Sayers, who I performed with also and should know his name, but I don't really know anyone's name. I have to perform his life. So I want to thank again to my wonderful band. And I hope to hear an encore, because that's what we do. One major pop star whose songs I did not sing tonight, because I didn't, and I will sing one of them now.